Welcome to New Salem's virtual worship experience. Please keep watching after the sermon to hear more important information and updates.
Good morning, America. Thank you for tuning in to This Week with Bill O'Neill. I am the said aforementioned Mr. O'Neill, so that means I kick the news for real, for real. It's August 29th, 2021. Today we have a very special guest indeed, and by special I mean he's super special. This man needs no introduction, so we're going to get right to it. You may know him as Mr. Nature Boy, but he goes by Sick Hair. Mr. Bill O'Neill, woo! See, I'm still jet plane flying, limousine riding, broke back praying, woo! I'm Sick Hair, and see, I'm not just sick here, I'm sick everywhere. I'm sick over there where I always won. I'm sick over there where I'm still winning. You better ask somebody. Woo! Mr. Nature Boy, Sick Hair. Mr. Sick Hair, the question that seems to be on viewers' minds everywhere, how did you manage to win so much? And how come you never lose? How did I always win? See, a lot of y'all, woo! Be reading the Bible. But see, I believe the Bible. So it says, woo, everything's always possible. I may be paraphrasing, woo-hoo, but at the same time though, when it said I can do all things, that means I'm always win, 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 win. Woo, forget everything else. Sick Hair only knows how to win. I don't know about the losing. Woo!
Not completely clear why you feel the need to yell every answer at me. In the words of my producers in my earlobe, tone, 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 sir. Now, one more question. This is the last one. How on earth is it you seem to be convinced you are God's gift to women, God's gift to wrestling, and also God's gift to any man who needs a man like you to be his role model? Mr. Sick Hair.
I'm fearfully, woo, wonderfully, woo, I'm fearfully, wonderfully, marvelously sick hair. So that's all I know. God made me, so I'm always gonna win, and I don't, woo, never lose. And as far as yelling my answers, how about this right here?
Woo. Good morning, New Salem, and welcome to our Sunday morning sermon. We want to thank you for tuning in. We want to know that we love you. Amen.
Good morning, New Salem family, friends, and guests. I'm Dawn Brown, representing the prayer ministry today. Our scripture for this morning is Psalm 106, verses 1 through 5. Praise the Lord. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Who can utter the mighty acts of the Lord? Who can declare all his praise? Blessed are those who keep justice, and he who does righteousness at all times. Remember me, O Lord, with the favor you have toward your people. Oh, visit me with your salvation, that I may see the benefit of your chosen ones, that I may rejoice in the gladness of your nation, that I may glory with your inheritance. Let us pray. Father God, we bless you. We thank you, Lord God. We ask even now, Lord, as we come into this space, Father, prepare our hearts, Lord God, prepare our minds for worship unto you, Lord. Father, we want to come in magnifying and glorifying your name, Father, for those mighty acts that you have done, Father God. And not just for your mighty acts, God, but for who you are. Father, you have been so faithful to us, God, and we want to always lift up our hands in praise. We want to dance with our feet in praise. Father, we want to shout for joy and praise to our mighty God. So, Lord, as we come today, Lord, I pray even now over our service, God, that you would bless those that are involved, Father God, for the musicians, Lord God, for the psalmist, Father, for the preached word that will come forth, Lord God. I thank you even now, Lord, that we're able to hear your word and to know that we can be encouraged by your word, Father, that we can place our very names in your scriptures, Lord, and know that your promises are true for us, Lord. They are yes and amen because we believe in Christ Jesus. So, Father, I thank you and I praise you even now. Let us come forth, Lord God, boldly to your throne of grace where we receive mercy. Lord, thank you for loving on us and calling us your very own. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Put your hands together if you're just glad to be alive on today.
What?
lift up our hands, no matter the circumstance, no matter the issue, no matter the sound problem, no matter what you might be going through. You can just lift your hands in praise, and it'll be okay. It'll be just all right. Death can't stop your praise. No problem can stop your praise. He's bigger than the problem. Your praise is bigger than the problem. No matter the issue, just give God glory. Hands up, hearts open wide as the sky. We lift you your name high, everybody sing it.
Names fade away. All the other names fade away. It's a great day to be alive. It's a great day to be alive. We thank God for a day that we've never seen before. We're grateful to be worshiping again with the New Salem family in Columbus, Ohio. We welcome our virtual audience as well as those who are tuning in and those who are watching in town. Thank you for sharing with us. We ask now that you bow your heads in a word of prayer. God, we thank you for reminding us that this whole world belongs to you. In good times and bad, and ups and downs, you're still a good God. Remind us in our valleys, in our down times, in our low times, that the whole world does belong to you. God, we come rejoicing in your love, in your care, in your patience, and in your grace and mercy. Bless us now and bless those who worship as we seek to praise your name, glorifying you and edifying others. We ask in your son's name, amen. We have now been in this pandemic 14 months, give or take a few days or weeks. And I think this time frame has tested the church in ways that it's never been tested before in my lifetime. It's been interesting to watch the ebbs and flows of people coming back to church virtually or raising the question, what is the purpose of the church? How is the church handling this? Where is the church? When's the church going to open up? And so this morning, I want to go back and do some basic biblical study this morning so that we at least can move forward with an understanding of where the church is and what is the church's purpose. This morning, I want us to really think about what is the reason God founded and birthed the church. What is the church's purpose? It's been my experience that people expect a lot of things from the church that have nothing at all to do with the biblical mandate. And so this morning, I want to go back and re-look at the fundamentals of what the Word says we ought to be about. The word purpose is defined as the reason for which something exists or is done, an intended or desired result. It's based on the definition of the word purpose. We can see how we need to consider the reason why we do certain things in order to plan for a more productive outcome. Proverbs 19, verse 21 says, many are the plans in a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. Say that again, Pastor. Many are the plans in a person's heart, but it's the Lord's purpose that prevails. If we don't know the Lord's purpose as a church, then we cannot plan for success, and thus we will not see desired results in reaching the world for Jesus Christ. Our ultimate goal is to reach the world for Jesus Christ. So this morning, I want to hold up the second chapter of Acts, verses 40 through 47, and we're going to walk through those verses this morning to try to relook at and redefine and repurpose and reestablish what are the purposes of the church. In these verses, you will find that there are five major reasons or purposes that God gave birth to the church. It's designed for every church, and we're going to look at them this morning. If you ever wonder why the church exists, then let's open up our Bibles and get started. In Acts, that second chapter, verses 4 through 47, what we see happening here is a founding of the New Testament church, as many people were saved as a result of the signs and wonders of Pentecost and the preaching of the gospel by Peter. We see here a picture of what Christ intended the church to be, functioning as it should, with love and unity. There are five important things that take place in this passage. So the first purpose that we want to hold up, the reason the church was founded, is the fact that the church is founded to evangelize through outreach. What is the church's first purpose? Our first purpose is outreach. Say it again, Pastor. Our first purpose is outreach. Matthew 28:19 says, Jesus said, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. The word go in the Great Commission should be read as you are going. The Great Commission doesn't say if you choose to go. Notice it emphatically says go. It doesn't say for the lost to come or rather come to church. The church ought to be going to where the lost are and not expecting the lost to come to us. And maybe the reason we've lost our voice and lost our power in certain places is we keep wanting folks to come to us as opposed to being obedient to what the word says. The word says go. We must take the initiative and go after the lost. We must take the message of Jesus Christ out into the world. It is called outreach, not inreach. And too many times we as churches are only concerned about those inside the building, which causes us to be disobedient to that great commandment. Making disciples and teaching them about Jesus is done through outreach. Acts, that second chapter, verses 40 and 41, tell us, and with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. Can you imagine being in a place where 3,000 people give their life to Christ? Peter was preaching the gospel based on the Old Testament prophecy about Jesus Christ. He was sharing the good news of salvation through Jesus. Therefore, we see that one aspect of the church's purpose is telling people about Jesus. It has been said outreach is more than our responsibility. It is our great privilege. It is a privilege to be able to tell folks about Jesus. We are invited to be a part of bringing people into God's eternal family. I don't know of a more significant cause to give one's life to. If you knew the cure for cancer, I'm sure you'd do everything you could to get the news out. It would save millions of lives. But I'm here to tell you, you already know something better than the cure for cancer. You've been given the gospel of eternal life to share, which is the greatest news of all. If we really realized how great the news is that we have, we'd be more about being about it. So the first purpose is to tell the world about this man called Jesus. It is outreach. Any church that's going to be about what God is asking to do cannot simply be localized internally. It has to look outside of itself and bring the good news to folk who may not ever come to us, but the word says we ought to go to them. Which brings us to the second purpose. The second purpose of the church is found in verse 42. It says, and they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. We see here the mention of prayer. So what exactly is prayer? It is communicating with God. Real prayer is expressing our devotion to Him, inviting Him to talk to us as we talk to Him. Prayer is an act of devotion and therefore an act of worship. So the second purpose of the church is not only to outreach, but to engage in worship. The second purpose of the church is to engage in worship. You may have heard the word kingship, which means to sit in the position of the king, or sonship, which means to sit in the position of a son. Well, worship means to sit in the position of worth. We will worship the Lord. We ascribe worth to Him because He sits in the main position of worth in our lives. There's nothing in our lives that is more valuable, worth more than our relationship with Jesus Christ. So everything else I do ought to be secondary to the worth He brings to my life. Whenever we worship the Lord, We lift him high as a banner. We exalt him. When we exalt, the church will grow. If we lift high his holy name, then all people will be drawn to him. The church grows when we exalt Jesus Christ. Throughout scripture, we're commanded to celebrate God's presence by magnifying the Lord and exalting his name. The psalmist says in 34:3, "So, oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let's exalt his name together." We shouldn't worship out of duty. We should worship because we want to. We should worship because we enjoy expressing our love to God. Every time we get a chance to worship, it's expressing our love to him. So the first purpose is outreach. Why do we exist? The second purpose is worship, which brings us to the third purpose. The third purpose of the church is fellowship. It's right there in Acts, the second chapter, verses 42 and 44. It says, "And they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship." Verse 44 tells us, "Now all who believe were together gathered in fellowship." So fellowshipping, gathering together, is a part of the church's purpose. Not to run in church and run out, but to fellowship. Fellowship emphasizes the fact that believers belong together. Say it again, Pastor. Fellowship emphasizes the fact that believers belong together. One of the reasons why the church exists is to fellowship or to help one another through the sharing of material goods and by being there to support each other morally and spiritually. Whenever we fellowship with other believers, we encourage one another. So church ought to be a place where people can come and find encouragement. Paul said this in Romans 1, verses 11 and 12, "For I long to see you that I may be encouraged together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me." Fellowship is for encouragement. So we come to church to encourage somebody else. So I can't just be in this worship experience with my arms folded, only caring about what I want, what moves me, what speaks to me. Part of my reason for being a part of the family of God is to encourage somebody else. He also admonishes us in Galatians 6:2, "Bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ." So another aspect of church purpose is encouraging other believers through fellowship. So I'll encourage somebody. I engage in worship and I engage in outreach. As Christians, we're called to belong, not just to believe. We are not meant to live a lone ranger life. Instead, we are to belong to Christ's family and be members of his body. We have each other for support. That's Ephesians 2, verse 19. You are members of God's very own family. Say it again, Pastor. You are members of God's very own family, and you belong in God's household with each other. The church exists to provide fellowship for believers. So that means you can't come to church and not be speaking to folks or ignoring people. It exists for fellowship, which then brings us to the fourth purpose. And maybe this gets a little deeper. The fourth purpose of the church is discipleship. The Great Commission says, "Go therefore and make disciples." The word disciple here means the pupil of a teacher. Acts 2:42 says, "And they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine." The word continue means they studied the apostles' doctrine. Here refers to the content of teaching. They took time to study the word. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, commands us, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." It's backed up by Proverbs 15:28. "Tell us the heart of the righteous studies how to answer." Studying the word, strengthening the faith of believers, and gives a foundation on which to stand and principles to live by. You can't have a foundation if you don't study the word. in Colossians 2, verses 6 and 7. As you have therefore received Christ Jesus, the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Discipleship builds people up. Discipleship builds people up in the Christian faith. As a church, we are called not only to reach people, but also to teach people. After someone has made a decision for Christ, he or she must be discipled. It's the church's responsibility. It's the church's responsibility to develop people to spiritual maturity. This is God's will for every believer. Paul writes, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we are all reach unity in the faith, in the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Ephesians 4, 12 and 13. So you have to understand, it's not just enough to get people here. What are we doing to help people mature in the faith? Which brings us to the final purpose, and that's purpose number 5. The fifth and final purpose of the church is service or ministry. It's found in verse 45 in that second chapter. A marvelous phrase. It says, they gave to anyone as he had need. Giving is an act of service. It is looking beyond ourselves and our own desires in order to provide for the needs of others. The church ought to be a place where people's needs can be met because we meet them through our own overflow. Service is actually commanded in the Bible. 1 Corinthians 10, 24 says, let no one seek his own, but each one the other's well-being. So when we come to the church, we should put other people's well-being in front of our own. And it goes on to say, the Bible says that pastors ought to equip the saints for the work of ministry. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, ministry is not being served. Ministry is serving. 2 Corinthians 8, 9, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus, that though he was rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich. In other words, he says he became poor so you and I could become rich. Well, if that's the case, are we not as believers supposed to follow his example of servanthood so that we can make people spiritually rich just as Jesus did? So the final aspect of our purpose is equipping believers to participate in serving others. Service is ministry. So as a believer in Christ, I ought to find a ministry where I can serve other people. The church exists to minister to people. Ministry is demonstrated God's love to others by meeting their needs and healing their hurts in the name of Jesus Christ. Each time you reach out in love to others, you are ministering to them. The church is to minister to all kinds of needs. What are you saying, Pastor? The church doesn't get the choice to pick and choose who it wants to serve. We're to minister to spiritual needs, emotional needs, relational needs, and physical needs. Whatever the need is, it is our responsibility as a church to serve those folks. So we have to be very careful when we want to pick who we're going to serve. You don't serve people because you like them or they agree with you. God says, whosoever I send through that door, regardless of the situation or circumstance, as the church of Jesus Christ, we have to be willing to serve them. So, very succinctly, that's why the church exists, to serve. To worship, to to evangelize, to encourage, to do all the things that we humanly need to make it through. Who hasn't needed encouragement through this pandemic? Who hasn't needed a word of advice or a word of comfort? How many folks have needed to be served? Our outreach through our food pantry has quadrupled through the pandemic because people needed to be served. We cannot worship and not serve, and we cannot serve and not worship. If we're true to what the Bible says the church is called to do, may we pray. God, thank you for the reminder that sometimes a lot of what we're doing has nothing all to do with the biblical mandate. It makes us feel good. It makes us want to brag on ourselves. But every now and then, we've got to come back to what the Word says. Outreach, worship, encourage. All these things, it's not one or the other. It's all five working in harmony, trying to balance out because people have needs. Strengthen us to be what you've called us to be. Not when it's convenient, but be what you've called us to be as we seek to be all we can in you through the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We encourage you now to become a part of a church with a purpose. To understand as a child of God, you and I are called to outreach, to reach people outside our comfort zone, outside the doors of church. We're called to engage in worship. We're called to encourage each other. We're called to serve. It's not a boring task. If you live this thing up to its capabilities, God will have you excited about getting up tomorrow. What a privilege it is to be used by God. Despite our faults and failures, God still chooses us to bless somebody else. That's good news. So I encourage you today, beyond the New Salem family, to become a part of the family of God. To become a part of the family of God. You don't have to jump through any hoops. You don't have to do any magic. Just say, God, today I choose you. You don't have to worry about him choosing you. He's already done that. He's just waiting for his love to be reciprocated back to him. You can do that by three ways here at the New Salem Church. You can send a text to 614-568-4858. You can send an email to nsprayerministry@newsalemcares.com, or you can visit us at church.newsalemcares.com/connect. It is our hope and our prayer that you'll become a part of God's family today. Don't put it off. We beg and we'll pray for you as you make those decisions. Amen. One of the great joys we have as part of the church family, part of the children of God, is this opportunity to give as we have been blessed. And ladies and gentlemen, if we're honest, we've been blessed more than we ever deserved. So here at the New Salem family, we give out of our response to his love. And so there are five different ways you can do that. You can visit us at church.newsalemcares/give. Number two, you can use our Shelby Next app to give. The third way is Cash App $NSCares. The fourth way, you can text your amount to 614-333-0656, or you can mail or drop off your gift here at the New Salem Church, 2956 Cleveland Avenue. We encourage you to be good stewards and give as God has blessed you. Amen. We prepare ourselves now to hear the good news of our top five announcements for this coming week. There's some exciting things that are going to take place, so please pay attention, ma'am and sir.
Greetings, New Salem family and all our special guests. These are your top five announcements for this week. Number one, for many of us, the past 2 years have been fraught with anxiety, depression, grief, frustration, and fear. Let's have some straight talk about the intersection of mental health and marriage. Save the date for New Salem's Marriage Conference 2021, Friday and Saturday, September 17th and 18. Go to the church website for more information. Number 2, the Life Development Youth Department invites all youth from 6th to 12th grades to the New Salem Institute Back to School Month of Ministry virtual series. It begins Sunday, September 12th at 9:30 a.m. Our virtual youth classes, known as Youth NSI, will feature themes such as maintaining joy and balance and how to create healthy boundaries for your new school year. Please register your youth for the amazing series designed for just for them. For more information, go to the church website or watch our social media channels. Number 3, September is Youth Month at New Salem, and every Wednesday in September from 6 to 7:30 p.m., our youth will gather outside at the Youth and Young Adult Patio behind the Bread of Life Food Pantry for the WAVE Youth Fellowship. We will begin September 1st with an open mic featuring hip-hop, song, poetry, drum kit, keyboard, and more. Further details can be found on the Youth GroupMe, Remind app, and the church website. Number 4. Beginning Saturday, September 18th, the New Salem Bread of Life Food Pantry will offer Saturday volunteer opportunities from 10 a.m. to noon. This is a great opportunity for our care groups, ministries, and high school teens interested in making an impact through community service. We need your help, and all are welcome. Go to the e-newsletter or the church website for the registration link. And number 5, tune in to Wellness Wednesdays on Facebook Live and YouTube Live at 5 p.m. with Sister Janae Shelby Stevens for a discussion about the possible connection between diabetes and Alzheimer's. All these announcements can be found on church.newsalemcares.com or in the link below. Please follow us on social media for updates and information throughout the week. These are your top 5 announcements. Have a wonderful week.
May we receive the benediction. Our Father, our God, we come grateful. God, sometimes we just got to go back to basics and fundamentals and remind ourselves the business we're in. Sometimes, God, we can get caught up so much in the glitz and the glamour and the applause that we forget to carry out what you've mandated in your word. So God, help us be faithful in what you've called us to do as we seek to be obedient to your will and your way. It's your servant's prayer. Amen, amen, and amen.